Thank you, Jesus, for drawing us to your house today, Lord. Lord, you said, your father's house will be called a house of prayer, a house of communion with you, Lord. And that's what we're here today to do, to commune with you, to hear from you, to rest in your presence, Lord, and to acknowledge you as the only one who is mighty to save. Lord, you are mighty to save, Lord. We come to you knowing who you are, that you are able, that you are more than able to save us, Lord, to restore us, God, to move mountains in our lives, Lord. We come humbly to you to worship you today. You are our Lord, and you are mighty to save.
Everyone needs compassion, the love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the Savior, the hope of
don't you have a seat? But don't leave that place. Don't leave that place of worship. The guys are going to come forward, and right in that vein of worship, we want to give to the Lord. Because, Lord, we want to see our giving as worship, as what it is. We want to see it as a sacrifice of praise, Lord. A thank offering. The first fruits, Lord, of all that you've given us. Lord, the ability to come and to give something to you, Lord, besides the praise of our lips, to tangibly say, you and you alone are Lord. You are awesome and you are mighty. You are our provider and our healer. You are our strength and our comfort, Lord. All that we have comes from you. And we bow humbly in acknowledgement of that. And we give in that heart, and that heart of worship, not out of obligation, but as a meaningful movement and action on our part. Lord, take every dollar and bless it. Continue to do great and eternal things with every dollar. Continue to bring your plan and your purpose to pass in this place and around the world. And give us a heart for heaven, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You're awesome in this place, Lord. We just give in humble acknowledgement of who you are today. Make it real in our hearts, Lord, for your glory, Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
Father, we come before you, Lord. Just thank you for being here, Lord, in this place, Lord, amongst us, Lord. Fill us with your spirit, Lord God. Build us up in the most holy faith, Lord God, in your most holy faith, Lord God. Lord, empower us through your spirit, Lord. Rebuke anything and everything that is not of you, Lord. Fill us with your spirit, Father. Pour your spirit out upon us all, Lord God. We desire you and you alone, King Jesus. You are worthy, Lord. I thank you, Jesus, for who you are, Lord God, for the joy of your salvation in our lives, Lord God. You are holy, Lord God, and I thank you, Lord. That stuck in my mind, Father. Just thank you so much. In your holy name, King Jesus, amen.
Amen.
And amen. Well, if you weren't already sitting down, I'd tell you to hug somebody. You can do a little high five or knuckles or, you know, just hit the person next to you in the shoulder. Hey, dude. Hey, Jen. Hey, Anthony's doing great, ending his first semester of school. Amen. Thank you to everyone who's given for Anthony's first half of his schooling up at the Bible College in Yucca Valley. He's going to be around here working all summer. So support him in that. He'll be doing a lot of work here at the church, but might be willing to work at your place too, but we're going to try to keep him from having to get a job so we can just keep him close to the ministry and send him back to school in August. So praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's good to see some friends in the room today. Thanks for coming to church today. Man, oh man. We don't have a lot of time to chat because it's Communion Day, which is good news. Let me just say a couple things before youth takes off. The handout you have today is mostly about food, so that's got to be good, right? So we're going to start having the barbecues, summer barbecues, the 13th, second Wednesday of the month. So be sure and mark your calendar. Come out on Wednesday night. Have a barbecue dinner with us. Come to the study and be blessed. Men's breakfasts are always fun. So that's the 9th coming up there. That's a lot. See, we get to eat twice that week, the 9th and the 13th. So that's good news. And listen, we have just this opportunity for you to be blessed and store up treasures in heaven and increase your reward abundantly for eternity by serving in the children's ministry. So if all those things sound good to you, there's a couple spots available. Not too many, actually. They're doing great in there, being blessed. Speaking of that, VBS is coming. VBS is like... It's just pressing on us every moment of every day. So sign up for VBS out front under the Easy Up. Invite your neighborhood friends. And we've got stuff in the schools. We'll start the digital marketing, social media, and email, and signs are going up in the whole nine yards. It's going to be off the hook here the week of June 25th. So be part of that. I think we need about 50 people, 55, something like that, for volunteers. And I haven't asked because I just I protect myself sometimes. You know, what you don't know doesn't depress you. So I shouldn't say that. We're probably 20 people short or so, and we have 3 weeks. So we need you. We need you. And you're gonna have to like take a hit, you know, work wise. Okay. And serve the Lord that week. I mean, you just do, right, Brenda? What? Not. Listen, take some time off. Call in sick. See me. I'll kick you in the shins. You can call in and say, oh, this guy kicked me in the shin. I can't come to work. I got to go help. And youth, high schoolers, young adults, man, oh, man, we need you guys. Honestly, we are too old for this. That's the truth. So... Jackie and Andrew are going to inspire you. And if you have really anybody seventh grade and up who will be a benefit, you know, who'll come to serve, man, we need you all just to interact with the kids. VBS is for going into kindergarten to sixth grade, going into college to help. I'm sorry, I just got a text. Every time someone texts me during church, I'm like, don't you know what I do for a living? You would say, why is your phone on the music stand, Dave? Because I got to update my Facebook, you know? No, don't write me anything on Facebook because I visit it consistently once a quarter. So, all right, youth, see you later. I don't have time to chat. Like I said, communion day, so we're anxious to do to get to communion. Sign up. Stephanie, get them all signed up for VBS, man. Dylan, we need you, bro. Seriously. VBS is like, it's off the hook. It's wild. Josh, you all right? Open your Bibles. Let's do this thing. I have to do one more message. I have to do one more message about how the Holy Spirit provides all that the body of Christ needs through the individual gifts that he gives each one of us in the body. I have to do it. We've done two. I have to do one more, but this is it. After this, we're going back to the verse-by-verse study of 1 Corinthians. It's just an incredible place to develop this truth. Let me say it again. It won't be the last time. The Holy Spirit provides all that the body of Christ needs through the giftings that he gives us individually. You guys are looking at the wall because I didn't tell you the title, huh? I appreciate that. You can point at the wall, Nicole. Title of the message, Fulfilling Your Role. You knew that already, didn't you? Fulfilling Your Role. The people listening didn't know that. 1 Corinthians 12:27 is the key verse. To move off of this next week, let me give you three series that you can study on your own so that we can go back to verse by verse through 1 Corinthians there on the wall also. First one's Growing in the Holy Spirit. It's a four-part series we did recently. Focuses on growing in the Holy Spirit, growing in your knowledge and your interaction, your experience with the Holy Spirit. It was a fun series. Back in 04, when some of you were just still children, we taught a series called The Holy Spirit. And you can get that series. We're not going to do in this mini-series, we're not going to go through the gifts individually because it's massive. In that series, the Holy Spirit series we did in 04, six of the 12 messages are just systematically going through the gifts that are listed in the Bible. And so that's half that whole series. If you're interested in the individual gifts, get that. And then lastly, within the Romans series, we did this fun four-part, I kind of do these mini-series things. This fun four-part mini-series called Under His Influence in Romans chapter 8, messages 14 to 17 in the Romans series. Get those at CalvaryNuevo.org at the website or download the Word by Mail phone app, our Bible teaching phone app. Do that on your own so I can move on, okay? You can even ask Pam. You can get a blue card, ask Pam, and you could get you know, what we used to use, you know, back in the day, is a disc, silver disc. We call it a CD. Some of you still use them. And we can even make those for you out of the archives. So you go study the Holy Spirit on your own with those series. I'll pray. We're going to do one more message today on fulfilling your role in the body, and then we'll move back to verse by verse. Is that all right? Okay, let's pray. Lord Jesus, we just want this to stick, Lord. We want to know. We want to know, Lord, what specifically you made us for. Lord, how you made us to meet the needs in the body uniquely and specifically. We want to know the place you made for us and the giftings you gave to us. And Lord, we want to begin the journey to find out where we were made to be in the body of Christ and to fulfill our role there. And so we pray, Lord, that you would seal this in our hearts and minds and that you would drive us to this beginning today for your glory. And in your name, Jesus, amen. Amen. So I started out, when I started the message, I started out by listing 8 verses that all said the same thing. And I was going to read them all to you, kind of shotgun style. Here's what every one of these verses said. They said that the Holy Spirit gives each member of the body a gift for the good of the body. Over and over again in the New Testament, we're told that each of us have received a gift from the Holy Spirit for the profit, for the benefit of the body of Christ. But for time's sake, I had to take them all out. So they're there. Either believe me or go find them yourselves. But the key verse I have to put up, 1 Corinthians 12:27. All of you together are Christ's body. All of you together are Christ's body, and each of you is part of it. This is such a crucial truth to understand, is that all of us together are Christ's body. In the universal body of Christ, we are all Christ's body. And in this fellowship of believers, we are Christ's body. And each of us is part of that body. What is our role? And how do we go from where we're at now to fulfilling our role in the body? That's the point today. Grant Shaw 2 weeks ago taught on the attitudes that prevent us from fulfilling our roles. It was a great way to start this little 3-message focus. And then last week we asked that huge question, what were you made for? When God fearfully and wonderfully made you in your mother's womb, Psalm 139 says, when he crafted you, when he made your innermost parts, your soul, your makeup, what did he make you for? That's our goal today, is to get you started on this journey to answer that question and then fulfill it. Last week, we looked at the 3 major gift lists, so we're not going to do that anymore. We looked at manifestation gifts. In 1 Corinthians 12, how God manifests himself through the gifts of the Spirit. We looked at creation gifts in Romans chapter 12, what God made us to be. And we looked at leadership gifts in Ephesians 4, how God gifts us to lead the church. None of those gifts or gift lists are complete. None of them are inclusive or exclusive. They're all guidelines, like the pirates say, you know, it's just a guideline. They're guidelines. The gifts in the ministries and the services of the Holy Spirit are so diverse and so many that we can't put a box around them. We can't put a line around them. God refuses to allow us to box him in by our limited understanding. What we do know is that each one of us has a place. Each one of us has a role. And as we fulfill that role, the body of Christ functions supernaturally, functions miraculously, functions for the glory of Jesus Christ. The problem is we don't know what our role is, and we don't know how to fulfill it. Too often, we just don't know. We can even grasp the concept that I believe the word that I was made for something, but how do I go from where I'm at now to there? And often the church has used spiritual gift tests. Have you seen them? We've used them here, and I don't want to totally throw them out the window, but here's the truth, all right? Don't you like to know the truth? The truth is, the spiritual gift tests are personality tests with scripture attached to them. You know, they're psychology. And not all psychology is bad or good. It just is what it is, but it's the study of how your mind works. And so these spiritual gift tests are often the world's way of determining who you are, and then they find scriptures to attach to them for the gifts. I've used them. They do have a place. I don't mean to totally disregard them. Here's the problem. God has so much more for you in the journey. That's what I want to say today over and over. I want to say the journey. God has so much more for you in the journey of finding out where he made you to fit and how you can fulfill the role, that it's really a bit of a tragedy to just bypass all of that and try to get a quick fix, take some tests, and then get to work for God, right? That's what the church wants you to do, you know, because we need people to work for God. So here, quick, take this test and get to work. But God's not like that. Here's why. It's on the wall. The Bible is not about a process. The Bible's about a person. The Bible is not about a process for how to live or how to work or how to grow a church. It's about the person of Jesus Christ. The Bible is not about a recipe, it's about a relationship. And the relationship and the person of Jesus Christ and knowing him grows in your life in the journey, not in some process that ends with some box checked off so you can accomplish some task, but it's the journey that develops your knowledge of the Lord, your relationship with the Lord, and it's in the journey that the Lord transforms you. He molds and shapes you to prepare you to fit in the exact spot he made you to fit in. In fact, the journey in many ways is more important than the end result. We want the end result. We want it in a microwave, fast microwave, commercial microwave. You know, I mean, seriously, we want it now. But God says, no, let's take a walk. Let's take a walk together. Give me some years. You know, if God would tell you how long your walk with him needs to be before you're ready, you probably wouldn't agree with him. But it takes time. God says, why don't you walk with me? And while you're walking with me on this journey to find out where I've made you to fit and find out how you can begin fulfilling your role in the body, in that process, you'll know me better. You'll be filled with my life better. You'll be empowered by me better. And you'll be transformed so that you don't get in my way. It's in the journey. It's in the journey of finding and fulfilling our role that our relationship with the Lord really, really grows. So with all that said, I want to give you some background, some concepts to lead you on the journey today. Things that you can start this path with to say, Lord, I want to know what you've made me for. I want to find that spot and I want to fulfill my role. I want to do what I was made to do. Show me how. I want to help you get started knowing how. As we go through the journey, you'll see that everything that we look at is not just to accomplish the goal of you finding your place in the body, but it's you growing and transforming and becoming more of a spirit-filled Christ follower, being transformed more and more into the image of Jesus Christ. It starts in Romans 12. So let's turn there. We're done in 1 Corinthians after that key verse. Romans 12, 1-6, the first six verses of Romans are absolutely the ultimate goal. It's not so much prerequisite. I used to say prerequisite until I realized that, you know, 39 years later, this is still being accomplished in my life. So I understand more now, the older I get, that this is the ultimate goal. This is what we are moving towards. The first six verses in Romans 12, this is what God wants to do in you for you to be able to serve him in a glorifying, truly glorifying way. You ready? Romans 12, verse 1. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies. The word means all that you are, your entire makeup, all of your faculties. Give all that you are to God. because of all he's done for you in response for all the in response to all he's done for you, let them, meaning your bodies, all that you are, let all that you are be a living and holy sacrifice. Holy means set apart for God's use, for God's glory. Let all that you are be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. Look at this last sentence. This is truly the way to worship him. This is the way to worship him. Worship is a lifestyle. It's, you know, it's not a radio station. You know, it's a lifestyle. And certainly music is key, and singing out praises to the Lord is key. But true worship ultimately is giving all that you are to God because of all he's done for you, to be a living and a holy sacrifice for the glory of God. That's truly the way to worship him. Then verse 2 says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. Who says the church needs to read that verse? Come on, be honest. Okay, if you don't know, I'll just tell you. The church could use reading this verse. Stop copying the behavior and customs of the world. Yeah, but it builds really big churches. I know. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. I can only say that because we have a small church. If we had a big church, I couldn't say that. So, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you. Let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think, by renewing your mind. The word means that get a complete renovation, like the home shows on TV. Tear it out to the studs, tear the walls down, the roof's caving in, and then they rebuild it into a mansion. That's what this word means. Renovate your mind. Get a new one. Get a new one. Renew your mind. Change the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you. Isn't that what we want? In our service to the Lord and fulfilling our role in the Bible, isn't this what we want? To become a living sacrifice, holy to the Lord, and to find out his will for us personally. At the end of verse 2 says, which is good and pleasing and perfect. That's it right there. That's what we want. Lord, I want to know your will for me. I want to know where you've placed me. I want to know what you've made me for. Lord, I want to fulfill what you've created me to do. Right? Oh, that's good. Then Romans 3, the big warning inserted right in the middle of these, really what I would call the ultimate goals for serving the Lord. Romans 12, 3 says, because of the privilege and authority God has given me, I give each of you this warning. Don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourselves, measuring yourselves by the faith God has given us. This is a really clear and a very direct warning against pride, because you cannot serve the Lord with pride. Pride kills. Pride kills our ability to serve God in the Spirit. Pride kills our ability to fulfill our role in the body to the glory of God. We can work in the body, but our pride kills. It kills. Right? It does. Pride kills our ability to serve in unity in the body. And so the Holy Spirit, through Paul, warns us, don't think you're better than you are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourself. And then he says in verse 4, this is why, just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body and we all belong to each other. That's why the warning about pride, because pride divides the body. Pride brings conflict into the body. Pride just dismantles things around you. So the Holy Spirit says, be a living sacrifice, be set apart for God's glory. In verse 2, don't do things the way the world does them. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Crucify your pride and be part of the body. See it in verses 4 and 5? This is the journey, all right? The reason I'm going through this is because if you look at these verses, the first 5 verses, it's a journey of transformation to where God is using you. He's truly using you in a supernatural, spirit-filled way to change eternity. This is the process, the journey that we go through. And as we go through this journey, God transforms us by the renewing of our mind as we behold his glory. He transforms us from glory to glory. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, by the Lord who is the Spirit. It's the journey, and it's allowing the Lord to constantly refine and mold and shape us that gets us to the place where we can work together in unity in the body for his glory. Look at verse 6. This is the first half of verse 6 is the conclusion. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, reading from the New King James, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. That's why I went back to the New King James there. Let us use them. So once we go through this process of the first 5 verses of God really transforming us and putting us in this place that we can fulfill the role that we've been made to fulfill, then he says, okay, now having gifts differing according to the grace you've been given, that's charis, that's that grace gift, use them. Go ahead, step into that spot and fulfill that role that you've been made to fulfill in the body. That's good, isn't it? So you should always go back to Romans 12. You should always go back there. I start every, I start a lot of counseling sessions. At some point, this is always involved in counseling sessions, this set of scriptures, because it is the transformation set of scriptures, the process, the journey of transformation, and that's what we need before we can truly find our place and begin fulfilling our roles. I can tell you this, after 39 years of following Jesus for Pam and I, after 39 years and 27 or 28 years in the ministry, I'm still on the journey. This is not something that you arrive at. This is not something that you reach in this life. It's a journey. It's from glory to glory. God is transforming us. We're becoming more and more as a living sacrifice, being used more and more for his glory, being driven more and more by the Spirit and less by the flesh. After 39 years, I'm still in this journey. And it's not just because I'm thick-headed. I know that's what you're thinking. It's not just because I'm a slow learner. My prayer is that you would be on this journey for 39 more years. After I'm long gone, I pray you would still be on this journey of being transformed and being used and fulfilling your role in the body. It never ends. Amen? Man, that's a big thing. So, as you start your journey, I want to give you some guidelines, let's say, some vital truths to starting your journey. We just went through the process in Romans 12, and I pray you return often to those verses and let the Holy Spirit bring them back. But I want to give you an outline from Jim Hesterly. Jim Hesterly was the original premier Holy Spirit teacher in the Calvary Chapel movement. He was one of my primary Holy Spirit teachers. This outline's from him, and he deserves the credit. He runs Acts 1:8 Ministries, and his reward is waiting for him. A great, great man of God. This is his outline, and this is 4 vital truths that you can begin to walk the journey in to find and fulfill your role in the body, right? This is it. Remember, the process is what transforms you. We don't want a quick fix with Jesus. We want to walk with him and talk with him. We want to know him better every day, grow in our relationship with him. This will do it. Here they are on the wall. Number one, be faithful. Be faithful. Number two, be filled. Be filled. Number three, be flexible. Please be flexible. Number four, be focused. That's maybe the most important one. Be focused. You ready to go through them? All right, follow me through them. And as I do, as we go through them, look for the relationship core. Look for how, if you're moving through these four vital truths, you're actually growing in your daily relationship with the Lord. You're being transformed. You're becoming a new creation that Christ made you to be. Number one, be faithful. Turn to Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 6, the apostles were overwhelmed by ministry demands, if you can imagine that, and the church was complaining. Aren't you glad that doesn't happen today, where the church leaders are overwhelmed and the church is complaining? All right, so we've gotten over that, right? All right, so Solomon said there's nothing new under the sun. The apostles are overwhelmed, the church is complaining, and for a legitimate reason, the widows are being neglected, but there was really kind of a little conflict between, it's not really racist, but it's actually language speaking, widows. But anyway, so there's a conflict in the church. The apostles, the 12, tell the church to appoint 7 men to oversee this new ministry. Remember, the focus today is fulfilling your role. And so in Acts 6, we see how God gave direction to the church to fulfill the role that the body needed. That's why we're focusing in Acts 6. Acts 6, verse 3, these are the things that God is looking for in those that he would place in this new role, this place in the ministry. Acts 6, verse 3, and so, brothers, select 7 men who are well-respected, who are well-respected and full of the Spirit and wisdom, implied is full of wisdom. We will give them this responsibility. In a word, the 12 tell the church, find some men who are faithful. Find some men who are faithful right now, who are well-respected, full of the Spirit, and full of wisdom, all of those things being evidence in their life. Luke 16:10, don't turn there, it's not on the wall either, says, he who is faithful in little will be faithful in much. And so God says, we need some faithful men to look over this ministry. Go find someone being faithful now. Look for someone who's well-respected, full of the Spirit, full of wisdom. Look for someone who is currently being faithful now. Because here's the truth, guys. As we are faithfully serving right where God puts us, we find ourselves learning a very critical truth. And this is, please hear this. God is not as interested in what you are doing as he is in how you are doing it. God is not impressed with what you're doing, okay? And if you think he is, go back to the pride warning. God's not impressed with what you're doing, but he is looking at how you're doing it. What is your attitude? What is your heart condition? Have you ever had this interaction with your mom? For me, it was with my mom. She says, clean up your room. And then you stomp off with the worst attitude ever and start throwing stuff. We'll clean up the room, all right. You want it clean? I'll throw it out the window. And suddenly your mom's not concerned anymore about you cleaning up your room. She's concerned about how you're going about it, isn't she? Well, I'm cleaning up my room. Well, you better, because you're going to live in it for a year. God is like your mom. He's more interested in how you're doing something than in what you're doing. That's being faithful if we're serving faithfully where we're at, then God says, there's a faithful person. And so if they're faithful in what they're doing now, they'll be faithful in what I have for them next. I am blessed. We are blessed here as a church to have so many faithful servants here. People who have been serving for many, many years. Some from our first Sunday. I don't see, I called the Pruitts out first service, but I won't this service. We have people who just serve in the shadows. They serve. Here's why they serve. Here's why they serve. Because Jesus died for them. Because Jesus has a home waiting in heaven for them. Because Jesus is their Lord. What else can they do? They just serve him because God loved them first and saved them when they were his enemies. That's that faithful serving. We have a ton of those people here, and I'm incredibly blessed by it. First counsel, be faithful where you're at serving the Lord. This is the journey, the beginning of the journey to fulfill what God truly has for you in the body. Number two is be filled with the Holy Spirit. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Again, look down at Acts 6, verse 3. Select seven men who are well-respected and full of the Spirit. Guys, if we want to truly fulfill what God has called us to do and where God has called us to fit in the body, we cannot do that in the flesh. We cannot do that in the flesh. Serving God in our own strength leads only to conflict and confusion and burnout and breakdown. Nothing good comes from it. We must learn how to be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. Why? Because it's not by might, it's not by power, it's by my Spirit, says the Lord. Any real work that God does in the body of Christ, he does through a willing vessel, but it's not the willing vessel doing it. It's the Holy Spirit doing it through the willing vessel. And so anything you do in the flesh, believe it or not, you know, is not the Lord. It's the flesh. We must learn to be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. That's why Ephesians 5:18 says, being is the Greek tense, be being filled with the Holy Spirit. The best translation of Ephesians 5:18 is always be being. Always be being filled with the Holy Spirit. If you know that verse, Paul contrasts being filled with the Holy Spirit to being drunk. And he says, don't be drunk. Be filled with the Spirit. Why does he contrast that? People are always, why does he use, you know, such a bad contrast? Because what percentage of everything you are does alcohol affect when you're drunk? Everything. It affects how you see things, how you perceive things, how you act, how you react, how you feel, what you say. It affects all of your faculties. And Paul says, to that same extent, be filled with the Holy Spirit. So every thought, every action, every response, every reaction is driven by the Holy Spirit in you, right? Not by the flesh, but by the Spirit. That's why we've got to learn what that means to be always be being filled with the Holy Spirit. It's part of the journey. It's not a magic prayer and you know, whatever. It's actually a journey to learn, Lord, I need to be filled with your Spirit again today. Oop, new day, new filling, you know. I need a double filling today, Lord. Listen, the series Growing in the Holy Spirit, one of the messages, it's only a four-part series, second or third message, the whole message is on Ephesians 5:18. Always be being filled. So get that series, listen to it there, and I can move on here. So here's what we have so far. First, we practice faithfulness. This is in order to ultimately fulfill the role in the body that Christ has made us to fulfill and has made a place in the body for us to fulfill. First, be faithful where you're at. Second, be filled with the Holy Spirit. And third, be flexible. Be flexible. Be flexible. This is a great story in Acts 8. Turn over a page or two to Acts 8 and follow me through the testing of Philip. God tests Philip's flexibility here. This story speaks so loud and so clear to me. I pray it does for you. Here's the setup. Acts 6, Philip is one of those seven men chosen in Acts 6 to oversee the ministry needs for the widows, right? And Stephen also is first named there. Well, there's this wild psychopath crazy guy named Saul of Tarsus who's persecuting the church in Jerusalem. And so Philip, wise guy, decides he's been called to be a missionary. Okay, I gotta leave. All right, Stephen stayed and got to go to heaven before Philip, but Philip decided to go to Samaria. Look in Acts 8, verse 5. Philip, for example, went to the city of Samaria and told the people there about the Messiah. Now look at verse 6. This is the beginning of a mega church movement in Samaria. Verse 6, crowds listened intently to Philip because they were eager to hear his message and see the miraculous signs he did. Verse 7, many evil spirits were cast out, screaming as they left their victims, and many who had been paralyzed or lamed were healed, so there was great joy in that city. Do you see how many times the big words are used? The crowds in verse 6 are there. They're eager for the miracles. Many evil spirits, many who had been paralyzed or lame were healed. There was great joy. Philip was doing a great job. He was just about to begin formally the first mega church of Samaria. In fact, I think that was going to be his church name. I can't wait. You know, some churches have crazy names, don't they? I can't wait for a church to say, First Mega Church of Samaria. You know, it's coming, you wait. Look down at Acts 8, verse 14. This sends it off the hook. Acts 8, 14. When the apostles in Jerusalem heard that the people of Samaria had accepted God's message, they sent Peter and John there. Now the church in Samaria is blowing up. We kind of know, a little bit of a story of a young guy that Greg Laurie kind of helped him get started, helped him get his church started. And Greg Laurie would like show up and do crusades just for his church, just to fill people in his church. That's what's happening here. The heroes, the superstars are coming up from Jerusalem to help Philip get his mega church off the ground. Peter and John come, and they lay hands on everyone. Everyone receives the Spirit. The church is blowing up Gungam style. It's off the hook. It's out of control. In verse 25, look down at your Bible. In verse 25, Peter and John head back to Jerusalem. They leave this whole work in Philip's hands. And then in verse 26, Philip is tested by God. Acts 8, 26, as for Philip, an angel of the Lord said to him, go. What do you mean go? Not just go south. Not south of Samaria, south of Jerusalem. Go south down the desert road. Go to the desert. Go to the road that runs from Jerusalem to Gaza. And from Philip's perspective, there's so much wrong with this verse. There's so much wrong with the angel of the Lord saying these things to him. But there are two words that I imagine stood out just painfully to Philip. The first one is the word go. Lord, what do you mean go? Do you not see what's happening here? I mean, I got a mega church in its infant stage here. This town is blowing up for you. What do you mean go? Gaza? That's the second word that had to hit him so hard. You're serious? It's one thing to go to Samaria, okay? They were considered half-breeds and, not that acceptable, but the church was blown up there. Gaza was the pure enemies of God. Gaza was Philistine country. And in the first century, the enemies of God lived in Gaza. And in the 21st century, the enemies of God live in Gaza. And Philip's like, seriously, Lord, go to Gaza. So in Acts 8:27, best I can remember, Acts 8:27, Philip says, no way, Lord. I'm not leaving this. Are you trying to tell me that you don't have anybody else you can send to that God-forsaken Gaza? Why should I leave here? Everything's going great here. Is that what he said? Oh, that's what I would say. Acts 8:27. So he started out. So he walks away. New King James says he arose and went. Okay, Lord. Well, what are you, Philip, what are you doing? We got the big crusade coming. We got an American Idol finalist coming to sing at the crusade. You can't leave now. We're about to build a mega church. And Philip's like, yeah, I got to go. And so he starts out. Philip's been faithfully serving. He's been filled with the Spirit. And now God tests his flexibility, I believe, for our benefit. And so he walks away from the mega church in Samaria for one guy. One guy on the road to Gaza, the treasurer of Egypt under the queen of Egypt, the queen of Ethiopia, the treasurer of Ethiopia. We call him the Ethiopian eunuch. I don't know how he would feel about that. You know, like, can't you just call me Joe? Sorry, Joe. The Ethiopian eunuch, he's an important guy, obviously. He's a treasurer to the queen, and there's actually a historical connection to him and this thing in Acts 8 that's really cool. But following in Acts 8, there's this fabulous story of the Holy Spirit's leading of Philip. It's so incredible. We can learn so much from it. Philip ends up down there. The Ethiopian eunuch's, you know, reading the scroll of Isaiah in his chariot. Philip's like, hey, I just happened to be here. You want me to tell you about that? And so he leads this eunuch to the Lord. The eunuch asked to be baptized. And in Acts 8:39, we read this. When they came up out of the water after the eunuch was baptized, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away. The eunuch never saw him again, but went on his way rejoicing. This is a full-on Star Trek moment, okay? Philip comes up out of the water and Scotty hits the transporter button. Boom! And he just, you know how they, like, you know. All right? Okay, listen, when I was watching Star Trek, it was the 70s, okay? And so we didn't quite have the film magic that they have now, but, you know, they would like, how do you call that? Like, you would just see them disintegrate, you know, in the older versions. Maybe it's still the same, I don't know, I haven't watched it recently. But Philip gets transported up by Scotty, gets snatched away. He's gotta be like, when he's in a million pieces, like being moved, he's got to be saying, Lord, what is going on here? Look in verse 40, next verse. Meanwhile, I love that. Meanwhile, Philip found himself. He found himself farther north at the town of Azotus. It's Ashdod, still there today. He's 20 miles away, so he gets transported 20 miles away. What does he do? He, like, all his molecules come back together, and he says, hey, have you heard that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the Messiah? I mean, he just starts telling people about Jesus, right? In Ashdod, in Azotus, in LT, it's the same city. He preached the good news there and in every town along the way until he came to Caesarea, which is 60 miles up the coast, and he never goes back to Samaria, never. He never goes back to Samaria. He never has anything major happen in his life, but he raises up some daughters who are prophetesses that we meet later in Acts, and so that's really cool. But he stays in Caesarea, and he never returns to anything of any size, notable size. Does that mean anything to you? It means a lot to me, man. It means a lot to me. Do you see the faithfulness of Philip? Do you see the filling of the Spirit? If you read through Acts chapter 8, it's like, wow, this guy's in touch with the Holy Spirit. And do you see the flexibility? Seriously, Lord, whatever you want, you know, that whole beam me up thing's weird, but I'll go wherever you send me. And yeah, whatever happened to Samaria? Well, I mean, you're not allowed to go there today because they'll kill you as a Christian. I don't know, but I know that Philip was flexible. He was faithful, he was filled, he was flexible, and his circumstances and his situation were not governed by his own desires. They were governed by God alone. And he said, God, if this is where you want me, I'm gonna tell him about Jesus here. And if you do that weird Star Trek thing again, I'll tell Jesus about wherever I end, tell him about Jesus wherever I end up. It says a lot. Big or small, easy or hard, here or there, we must allow God to determine where we minister. We must. No social demographic studies, no windshield surveys, they used to call them for pastors. Philip didn't do a windshield survey and decide, I think I'm gonna go to Gaza. Finally, last one, closing quickly, a little behind. Number four, be focused. Be focused. Be faithful. Be filled with the Spirit. Be flexible. And above all, be focused. Be wholly and completely focused on Jesus Christ alone. Not your circumstances, not your plans, not your crazy ideas, not your opinion of yourself. Christ alone. We've got to be focused on Jesus Christ alone. The quickest way for you to be taken out of the ministry is to get focused on anything else but Christ. If something else begins to consume your mind in the ministry besides Christ, you're on your way out. It's just a matter of time. We've got to stay wholly and completely focused on Jesus Christ. Turn to Philippians 3 and I'll close. My phone, which is why it's up here, says I have, well, now that I've said that, says I have 2 seconds. I'm going to read some out of Philippians chapter 3 from the New King James Version, because these verses and back to verse 10 in Philippians chapter 3 have literally set the direction of my life and my family's life. If you were to say, Dave, what has driven you to not only follow the Lord for 39 years, but to serve hard for 28. It's these verses. These are the verses that drive me and have driven my family for all these years. Philippians 3, verse 12. Paul says, not that I have already attained or I am already perfected, but I press on. I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Do you know that Jesus Christ has laid hold of you for an eternal purpose? He's got you in a stranglehold. He's laid hold of you for something eternal. Are you laying hold of what he has laid hold of you for? Not that you've already attained, you never will. If Paul hasn't by now, certainly we won't. It's not that you're perfected. Are you pressing on? Are you pressing on to lay hold of that for which Jesus Christ has laid hold of you? That's what drives you through any storm, through any discouragement, through any difficulty. I press on to lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Continuing, Philippians 3, verse 13. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. I can tell you honestly today, these verses have saved my life. They have saved my ministry life. They have more than a few times been read back to me by my children and my wife in some type of come on, Dad. So many times my daughter Danielle has said, Dad, We can never leave our post. I'm like, who taught you that? Where'd you get that? We have to stay the course. We have to press on. We have to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus has taken hold of us. Whatever it is, at whatever level, in any place where Christ has put you, he has a plan for you. Get a hold of it. Lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of you. That's the driving force. That's the focus you have to have. It will get you through any circumstance, any situation. It will drive you to the goal, the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And there is one. Keep pressing on. Single-minded focus on Jesus Christ and his plan and purpose for you, no matter what. Be faithful. Practice faithfulness right where you're at. Learn how to be filled with the Holy Spirit every single day. Be flexible. When I say this, it's not casual. Be flexible for God's sake. For the sake of what God wants to do in your life, be flexible. Because listen, your plan may not be God's plan. I know your omniscience level might be, you know, equal to his, but your sovereignty's not there. Your omniscience isn't there. There's a chance your plan might not be God's. Let him have his way. Be flexible and be laser focused on Jesus Christ. Be laser focused on laying hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of you. And if you will, I promise you that in the journey, you will find what you've been made for and you will fulfill your role in the body of Christ. And that's everything. It's everything. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, Lord, as we prepare our hearts for communion, Lord, I pray that we would, God, that we would just desire this walk with you, that we would desire this journey with you, to get on this journey, to lay hold of that for which you've laid hold of us, to find that unique and specific place that you've made for us in the body of Christ, and to fulfill our role, Lord, whatever it is, God, that we would do what you've made us to do, that we would be faithful and filled with your spirit and flexible and focused, Lord, unstoppably focused on you, Jesus. For your glory, for your kingdom's sake, and in your name we pray, Jesus. Speak to us as we prepare for communion. Encourage us, Lord. Strengthen us. Bring us to our knees before a holy Savior who took our place on the cross. And Lord, may we confirm again that we will live for you because you died for us. Have your way in our hearts now, Lord. Amen.
Sing for sinners. Death.
One line of that song, dying for me, dying for me. Lord Jesus, you are the author and the giver of life. You are the creator of all that's been created. You are the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Are high and lifted up, and the glory of your train fills the temple. The cherubim and the seraphim fly constantly around your throne, singing, holy, holy, holy. The glory of all creation is in your hands, and you died for me. Lord, we can never understand how far down you came from your throne to the cross. We can't measure. We can't measure what it took for you to hang on the cross in our place and take the full wrath, the full penalty of our sin on yourself, so that you could offer us this eternal exchange of our sin for your righteousness. Lord Jesus, you died for me when I was your enemy. And then you offered me new life, your life, having conquered sin and death in the grave. You offer me your eternal life. And Lord, on that night that you were betrayed, at that Last Supper, Lord, with your friends, Lord, you gave them a way to say, remember, remember this. Remember what it cost. Remember who you are, Lord. And what you did for us. And you took the bread that night and you tore it. And you passed it around and you said, take, eat. This is my body broken for you, bruised and pierced through. Flayed open on the cross, hung the creator of the world. And Lord, we recommit anew to never take that lightly. To never think we've earned or deserved. To never be in anything less than awe. Reverent awe at what you've done for us. So we remember again today, Lord, price you paid for sinners like us. Let's take the bread together. And then you ate with your disciples that night, Lord, because sharing food was sharing life. And at the end of the meal, you raised the cup and you said, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me, and as often as you drink it, remember me until I come again in the kingdom. Lord, we thank you for the covenant in your blood. There's no other way. There's no other way, Lord, for us to be saved, to be washed clean, to be made righteous, to spend eternity with you, to have your life replace ours. There's no other way. And so we receive the covenant of your grace. We put our full faith, our full trust in it. And we thank you for all that it costs you to offer it freely to us. Let's take the cup together. Lord, we love you. Renew us, Lord. Revive and restore us. Fill us afresh and remind us of how great a salvation you've freely given to us. Place, Lord. May our praises never find end. May we always walk with praise on our lips and an increasing commitment to know you and follow you all our days. For your glory, Lord, for your glory in our lives and in the body of Christ, and in your name, Jesus.